Conflict in Ethiopia risks pulling in the neighbours. Eritrea's capital has been bombed by forces from the Tigray region. They say Asmara backs Addis Ababa in its ongoing military operation in their region. So, is the Horn of Africa facing a wider conflict? This is Inside Story. Hello and welcome to the programme. I'm Bernard Smith. A conflict in Ethiopia is spilling over its borders and threatening to destabilise the Horn of Africa. Tigray's leaders say they are at war with Eritrea because its forces have got involved in their fighting in their region. And they've launched attacks on Eritrea's capital, Asmara, despite its government denying involvement. Two rockets hit the city's main airport and a third targeted a state media building. Forces loyal to Tigray's ruling party have been fighting Ethiopian government troops for nearly 2 weeks.
Those who attack Tigray will not just attack and return home. We will retaliate while they are here and strike the airports from which they launched attacks. There is no place that we can't reach, and we will continue to attack selected targets that the invading forces are using against us.
Ethnic profiling and massacres are reported to be taking place, with both sides being accused of atrocities. Ethiopia's Prime Minister Abiy Ahmed says those who commit crimes against humanity and peace will be held accountable. Mohamed Ado reports from the city of Gondar.
The admission by the Tigrayan leadership that they carried out missile attacks against Asmara, the capital of Eritrea, means that the war in Tigray region of northern Ethiopia has officially spilled over international borders. Diplomats say Eritrea could get involved in the fighting quite soon. But when you talk to the Tigrayan leadership, they are adamant that Eritrean forces are already on the ground. Debretsion Gebremichael, the leader of the TPLF, maintains that there are up to 16 divisions from the Eritrean forces who are fighting in support of Prime Minister Abiy Ahmed's forces. There is no love lost between the Tigray leadership and the president of Eritrea, Isaias Afwerki. They have not seen eye to eye for almost two decades, ever since the Ethiopia-Eritrea war ended and a period of no war, no peace began. Of course, they've the past 2 years criticized Prime Minister Abiy Ahmed of hastily signing a peace agreement with Isaias Afwerki. They have also criticized him for what they call an unprincipled friendship with Isaias. Many people say that given the proximity and close friendship between Prime Minister Abiy Ahmed and Isaias Afwerki, he would not bat an eyelid coming in support of the Prime Minister of Ethiopia. And what does that mean for the Tigrayan People's Liberation Front? It means they are sandwiched between two heavily armed and powerful enemies. But again, they cannot be ruled out. With an estimated 250,000 troops and an arsenal of weapons that have been stashed over a very long time, there is every possibility, diplomats say, that this could be a protracted war, something that's not going to be good for either Ethiopia or the entire Horn of Africa. Mohamed Ado for Inside Story.
Thousands of refugees have fled the fighting to neighbouring Sudan, and they're still pouring in, despite being faced with dire living conditions. Medical workers fear a lack of shelter and proper sanitation could create a health crisis. And the UNHCR is warning it might not be able to provide aid for the large number of people arriving. Many refugees have also reported being traumatised by what they've experienced. Let's now bring in our guests, and joining us from Nairobi is Matt Bryden. He's a strategic advisor at the think tank Sahan Research. In Khartoum, Axel Bisschop. He is the UNHCR representative in Sudan. And in London, Martin Plaut. He's a fellow at the University of London and a specialist on the Horn of Africa. Welcome to each of you. First of all, Martin, I'll start with you. What is the risk of this fighting spilling over and escalating now?
Well, one could It's clear it's already happened. The attack on Asmara, the Eritrean capital, that happened yesterday late in the afternoon, early evening, was clearly an internationalization of the conflict. This came after there were repeated reports of Eritrean troops attacking the Tigrayans along the north of Tigray. So, I mean, it is already an international conflict. There are also some suggestions of drones coming in from the United Arab Emirates and being used to attack the Tigrayans. So we are already in an international conflict.
I mean, Martin, Eritrea says it's not involved, but you think it now is.
Well, let's put it this way. There have been repeated reports from many, many people from the diaspora. I mean, Eritrea never allows anybody into the country on a permanent basis to report. I mean, it is regarded as being at least as bad as North Korea in terms of being a secret country, one in which there is no real scrutiny. So, you know, there's no way of proving it. But people say they've spoken to their friends, their families. All of them say that there is both a vast amount of conscription of children into the army, that people have been moved up onto the front line, and now yesterday the report of the attacks with the rockets landing in Asmara. I think it's very difficult to think that there's anything other than an Eritrean involvement in this conflict.
And Matt, do you see this escalating then as well?
Yes, absolutely. I think, as we've heard, first of all, the fact that we have refugees crossing the border to Sudan, and that among those refugees are reportedly Ethiopian soldiers or ex-combatants who've laid down their weapons. We've heard of reports from Western Tigray, from near the town of Humera, of an offensive from the north, which is the Eritrean border. And the Ethiopian government itself has acknowledged that at one point when its forces were on the defensive, they retreated into Eritrea to regroup before crossing back into Ethiopia. So I think for all intents and purposes, there's no question that this conflict is becoming internationalized. And the likelihood is that as it escalates, given the scale of the forces involved and the degree to which they seem to be relatively evenly matched, more and more of Ethiopia's neighbors, regional partners, and international actors are likely to be drawn in.
And Axel, can you help us out with the numbers of refugees you're seeing coming across the border into Sudan at the moment?
Yeah, so at the moment we have received about 20,000 refugees from Ethiopia here in Sudan. We're working together with the government of Sudan to take care of them as best as it is possible. At the moment, they're actually coming in through three border crossings, but one is the major boarding crossing, and that's Hamdayet. It's a small hamlet on the border with Ethiopia. And here, the town has quickly filled up. We are together with the government, but also with some of the other aid agencies, such as WFP and UNICEF, but also a lot of other local organizations, such as the Sudanese Red Crescent, trying to assist as best as we can. And it is urgent, and we are trying to ensure that we get our relief materials positioned there in such a way that we can actually further take care and manage this crisis.
And what are the immediate needs, Axel?
Yeah, the immediate needs are food. I mean, food is always the immediate need, and many of the people are actually coming without anything. So they don't have any means of actually surviving. So we have to take care of them. Luckily, the local community there has helped out quite a lot, but there is a lot more which needs to be done. As was earlier indicated, there is also a need for water. Water needs to be purified. We have a river there, but it needs to be purified, and we're asking our partners, our water specialists, such as UNICEF, to actually help us out with that. There are also many, many children amongst this. About 50% is estimated to be children, so they have special needs which we need to take care of. Okay. So it's in principle, everything which an aid situation of this nature actually calls for.
OK. And Martin, those refugees seem to be fleeing from some of the reports that are coming out, some pretty grisly ethnic violence, people being killed and hacked at with machetes. What sort of ethnic rivalries have been unleashed here?
Well, if you go back to the arrival of Prime Minister Abiy, what he in a sense did was to sort of say that the ethnic federal structure of Ethiopia would be ended, or at least would be challenged. Mm. And, you know, the whole process meant that he was trying to bring authority back to the center. And there have been lots of people resisting this. But the particular quarrel in this sense is between local Amhara and the Tigrayans. The Amhara believe that land that belonged to them was stolen by the Tigrayans when they were running the country, and they determined to get it back. And some of their militia are involved in the fighting. Now, exactly who has been doing this terrible massacre that happened in the far west of the country, we don't know. Amnesty International suggested that it might have been the Tigrayans.
Yes.
Others now interviewing some of the refugees that are being looked after in Sudan are saying, no, actually, it was the Amhara that did it. So I think we need a real investigation, a close look at what happened. But it is an absolute tragedy that this is going on because, you know, in the end, the real enemy in Ethiopia is poverty. It has nothing to do with ethnicity. And using these kind of ethnic issues to kill each other produces nothing but violence and death and is no way forward at all.
I mean, Martin, could we be heading for civil war in Ethiopia when these ethnic tensions have been unleashed?
Well, we're not heading for it. We are in it. That's what we are in right now. And the real danger is that other groups, shall we say, like the Oromo, from whom Abiy came himself, but who now were deeply alienated by his treatment of them, maybe the Somalis. Others might be drawn into it or feel that they could be drawn into it. And there is a real fragility. One of the things that came out was a report by the US Institute of Peace a few days ago. And really senior American diplomats, including Assistant Secretary of State Johnny Carsons, he's a former Assistant Secretary of State, came out saying that there was a danger that Ethiopia could collapse. Collapse. It would be the worst collapse of a state in 50 years. Now, I'm not predicting that will happen, but these are people who are really serious about the Horn, and if they are worried about it, then I think we all should be.
And, Matt, do you fear the beginnings of a civil war here in Ethiopia with these tensions unleashed?
Yes, indeed. And I think, as Martin said, this isn't necessarily even the beginning of the civil war. There have been incidents of intercommunal and ethnic violence across the country over the past couple of years, including very serious massacres on the scale of what we have seen over the last week or so in Tigray. In fact, I saw just this morning a report of dozens of Ethiopians being massacred in the western Benishangul region. Now, we've also seen the Ethiopian National Defense Forces deployed to fight against Oromo rebels, mainly the Oromo Liberation Front and the Oromo Liberation Army, with whom Prime Minister Abiy initially entered into peace agreements and which appear now to have turned against him, as Martin said, having been alienated by his policies. So we see that the federal government is embattled on several fronts. It has seen the emergence of a new regional state in the Sidamo area of southern Ethiopia. And the reform agenda that Prime Minister Abiy promised when he came to power now seems to be perhaps building a life of its own and a momentum of its own that goes beyond the federal government's control. And is unleashing some of the centrifugal forces that have been suppressed in Ethiopia for decades.
Okay. And Axel, any indication or any estimate on how many more refugees you fear might end up crossing those borders?
I mean, we don't have any clear figures. We are, however, making some plans, and we are discussing this with the government of Sudan. I mean, as always, we would like to see that this is being solved as soon as possible in order for us not to mount a large operation, which is then later on very, very difficult to decommission and detangle. So at the moment, we're planning for the 20,000. We have plans for that. We have also pre-positioned stock for additional people, and we have up to 100,000, which is in our plan at the moment. However, this is very, very early in the stage, and as I understand the other panel members are saying here, it might be long, but at this stage for UNHCR or for the UN or for our host government here to say, it's very, very difficult.
Okay.
But we urge constraint, and we also would like to see that together we actually take care of these people in such a way that they have the immediate needs catered for.
Okay. Martin, can you help us understand why Eritrea might be interested in coming in alongside the Ethiopians to target the forces and the government of Tigray? Help us understand the past history between Tigray and Eritrea.
Well, it's a long and complex history, and in some ways goes back to 1960s and student politics in Addis Ababa, believe it or not. Differences in perspective, differences in ideology, for example, between the Chinese perspective and the Russian, Soviet perspective. But it goes very, very deep. And although the Eritrean rebels and the Tigrayan rebels, who are now in power in their respective regions, actually cooperated at some times, they also fell out spectacularly. And anyone who remembers the 1984-85 famine, the terrible famine that tore across Ethiopia, should remember also that the Eritreans closed the route in from Sudan for aid into Tigray. 100,000 Tigrayans had to march across rough terrain. Many, many of them died into Sudan to survive. And the Tigrayans have never forgotten this. And President Isaias of Eritrea has also not forgotten it. And he sees the Tigrayans as sort of his nemesis in the world, and is determined to rid himself of them. And it is an absolute tragedy, because in a sense what the Tigrayans are now find themselves in is in a pincer movement from north and south, from Eritrea and from the federal forces from Addis Ababa. And they are fighting for their lives. I mean, there is no way that they can give up. And in a sense, Prime Minister Abiy has also painted himself into a corner, which is why any suggestion this is going to be a short conflict, I think, is probably mistaken, unless there is huge pressure from the international community on both sides to resolve this conflict.
Matt Martin mentions that the pressure that the Tigrayans are under. Is there a possibility that Debretsion Gebremichael, miscalculated when he held those local elections in September and ignored the central government's command to cancel them?
Well, I think if a miscalculation means that did he expect a full-fledged military intervention so quickly, I'd be surprised if that was his calculation. But it's important to recognize that both sides in this conflict at that time were defending what they considered to be constitutional and legal principles. The Tigrayan leadership, as far as they were concerned, their mandate, the mandate of the federal government and regional governments, were ending. Elections were to be held on 29 August. And in order to renew the legitimacy of Ethiopia's political structures, of its parliament and of its executive, elections were absolutely necessary. So they went ahead according to the original schedule, as they understood it. On the other side, Prime Minister Abiy, who himself is not yet an elected leader and clearly aspires to be one, and his administration decided to postpone elections because of the COVID-19 pandemic, and to extend his term of office. So as far as the Tigrayans were concerned, and of course other opposition groups, the federal government has outlasted its legitimacy and is not in a position to dictate what is legal or illegal to the regions. Ethiopia also is a federal state, but many of the principles in its constitution are essentially confederal, with the power lying with the people and the regional states, not with the federal government. Uh-huh. So Tigray sees itself as defending its own sovereignty, the federal government defending Ethiopia's unity. And as I think, as Martin was suggesting, this is shaping up to be an existential clash between the two sides.
Axel, Martin also mentioned before the famine, the 1984-5 famine. Some of the refugees crossing back into Sudan are people who already left the camps. They're going back to camps they were in as a cause of that last famine. What are you hearing from people crossing now as to why they're going back to Sudan?
Yeah, it's true that actually we've had a lot of refugee camps, especially in this area, and we still have quite a lot of refugee camps in this area. We already, actually at the moment, we're hosting about 100,000 refugees from mainly Eritrea in the area. Now, the fact is that we had decommissioned a couple of camps and we are looking at actually reopening them. One of these is Umra Quba, and here we have, together with the government of Sudan, done an assessment to look at how many this site can actually host. But we are in urgent need of actually additional sites, mainly to decongest the border areas, because there are so many people there at the moment, but also to make sure that we move people from the border further inland, in order to ensure that we have a civilian character of the camp and that it doesn't come in harm's way. So we are looking at all the camps which we had at that time actually decommissioned, and we're trying to see if some of them are still suitable to host refugees. So it's not something which we would like to do, but in this case, it's something necessary.
Martin, we've been reminded repeatedly over the last 10 days that the Ethiopian Prime Minister Abiy Ahmed won the Nobel Prize for making peace with Eritrea, and we were led to believe there was going to be a process of democratization in Ethiopia. Is that project over? Is it Abiy's fault?
Well, isn't this the curse of the Nobel Peace Prize? I mean, Mr. Kissinger got it, Aung San Suu Kyi got it, and I wouldn't say either of them covered themselves in great glory afterwards. It's a real problem. You know, I don't know. I hope the project isn't over. Ethiopia definitely needs democracy, needs to resolve its conflicts in a peaceful way. But, you know, it has always been a country which, throughout its long history, has been ruled by very tough people who used robust measures, to put it bluntly. And, you know, will they be able to find another way forward? I hope so, but I wouldn't be too optimistic, shall we say.
OK, Matt, then I'll leave that last question to you. Do you think there is a quick way out of this for the Ethiopian Prime Minister, or are we heading for many long, dark days of internal conflict?
Well, I would like to be optimistic that there is a quick way out. The principles for which both sides are fighting are well understood. I mean, they're highly complex and very polarizing and emotive issues that have been part of the Ethiopian national discourse, as Martin said, for decades. But they are part of the discourse, and they can be managed through an inclusive dialogue, not just between the federal government and Tigray, but also other parties who feel concerned or alarmed about the direction that Prime Minister Abiy may be taking the country. Unfortunately, as long as the Prime Minister insists that this is an internal affair and has rebuffed multiple offers of mediation or facilitation, I believe the situation is likely to escalate. The terrain in Tigray favors the defenders, who are very heavily armed and equipped, They have fought for decades in those mountains before. And I think the longer this goes on, the more the grievances will accumulate and the harder this conflict will be to resolve.
OK. Gentlemen, thank you very much for the time being. We're out of time, unfortunately. But, yes, thanks to Matt Bryden, to Axel Bishop and to Martin Plaut. And thank you, too, for watching. You can see the programme again anytime by visiting our website, aljazeera.com. And for more debate, go to our Facebook page. That's facebook.com/AJInsideStory. You can also join the conversation on Twitter. We are at AJInsideStory. From me, Bernard Smith, and the whole team here, bye for now.